Hello, we're rolling into another episode of the DRH show. As usual, I talk to interesting people within psychology, mental health, and well-being. Today, I'm joined by a professor in social and organizational psychology at the University of Queensland, Professor Alex Haslam. Thanks for joining me.
Hello. Yeah. Hi, Dennis.
It's great to have you here, Professor Haslam. Let's start off with you telling us your background, your trajectory in life, and how you ended up doing what you're doing.
Well, that's a good question. I've been a psychologist all my life. I did my undergraduate degree at the University of St Andrews in the 1980s. I graduated from there in 1985. I actually originally went to university. The reason I went to study in Scotland was because I had an interest in English and maths. I wanted to do a joint degree in English and maths. And when in the Scottish system, I did those subjects, but you also have to do a third subject. And for fairly random reasons, I just chose to do psychology. And then as my degree evolved, I just focused more on the psychology. And, you know, in many ways, I'm still interested in maths and English and so on, but just in a professional sense. But yeah, when I was at university, I had a great supervisor, Margaret Weatherall. She's a famous, influential social psychologist. And she was a New Zealander, in fact, and she suggested that I come to do my PhD with her PhD supervisor, who was John Turner, who was at Macquarie University in Sydney at the time. So I went there to do my PhD with John Turner. I went after I graduated. I had a job for a year, but then I went to work as a postdoc with John when he moved to the Australian National University. I was there for many years. And then I moved back to the University of Exeter in the United Kingdom, and I was a professor there for a decade. And then my partner and I, that's Kath Haslam and I, moved back to Australia about 8 years ago, and we've been in Brisbane ever since.
Mm-hmm. That's a fascinating story. But of course, among other things, you're known for your work on social identity and leadership. So could you just explain to us how does social identity contribute to leadership and productivity?
Well, that's a long, you know, that's a, I give a course on this, and that's really like, that's like 10 one-hour lectures just to kind of really to flesh all of that out. But the basic story is that leadership, we argue, leadership is a group process, and it centers on leaders' ability to effectively manage groups, but more particularly people's psychological connection to groups, and that comes from their social identity, their sense of usness. And we argue that leadership is all about the creation and management of that sense of us members of this team, us members of this community, us members of this organization, us members of this nation. And effective leadership has to engage with the psychology of usness. It's not all about the psychology of I-ness or me-ness. And most of the leadership literature is written as if that is all that matters, as though all that really matters is the I and the me of leadership, what a leader is like as an individual. And we say, well, there's some importance to that, but the critical issue for a leader is how they relate to the group and how they're able to get the group to relate to them and their mission.
Mm-hmm. So basically, what you're saying is that leadership is all about, how you could improve the lives of your members, not just all about you trying to elevate yourself in terms of status.
Yeah, well, again, I think it's basically saying effective leadership is about working with and for the group, okay? Mm-hmm. And advancing the interests of the group. Yeah, not so it's about making us better. It's not just about making me better or, you know, or dealing with my own particular needs or whatever. So as a leader, you know, if you fixate on yourself as an individual and you think it's all about me, it's probably going to go wrong. But if you think it's all about us and you fixate on the group and its needs, you're much more likely to end up in a better place as a leader, but the group is obviously much more likely to benefit from your leadership, which is really the critical thing.
Mm. And how does social identity tie in with mental health?
So that's another really interesting story. So I started out as an organizational psychologist, a social psychologist. I was interested in things like group processes and things like communication and motivation and leadership around there. Well, I mentioned before, my partner, Kath, is a clinical psychologist, a neuropsychologist. And, you know, and we were always talking about stuff, and it became very clear in her work and the work that she and her colleagues were doing that group processes are also incredibly important for mental health. But when you look at the way that people talk about identity in a mental health space, again, they're often talking about individuals as individuals. And our work really says that mental health has a lot to do with individual status as group members. So, for example, if you want to look at when do people really suffer a hit to their mental health, it's when they lack group memberships or lose group memberships. For example, when they retire, or if a spouse dies, or if they lose their job or whatever. Those are the times when people are really vulnerable. And the issue there is that social identity loss or a lack of social identities is a real vulnerability for mental health. Why? Because we're social animals who derive our meaning and purpose from our connections to other people. And if you deprive us of those connections, in particular those group-based connections, then we're operating in an environment for which we weren't designed to function.
Mm-hmm. Now, I understand that you kind of highlight the importance of group-based identity, but I just want to explore another layer of identity. It used to be that when we talk about identity, especially in the field of psychology, it used to be seen as a psychological construct, but now it kind of evolved into a different take on identity with the rise of identity politics, you know, this kind of obsession, if you will, about identity, about me, about my lived experience. And I'm not trying to invalidate the importance of lived experience, but do you think this kind of, you know, take on identity is doing more harm than good?
Well, that's a complicated, again, and I'm probably going to say this to every question you ask, that's a complicated question. What I mean, the point about identity is, and social identity in particular, is the point is it's obviously not just a psychological construct. Group memberships are real things, and group memberships are concerns in the world, and they have, you know, economic, political, social consequences and aspects more generally. So, you know, I think that's the way the world is. That's how the world is. And again, part of, I think, the richness of identity and social identity as a construct is precisely that it doesn't just focus on the psychological. Actually, no, it tunes you into other things that are going on in the world, group-based realities, group-based conflict, tensions of different forms. So when you say, oh, identity politics, well, identity politics is just a way of saying that there are group differences in the way that we see the world and the way we respond to it. Well, I don't see. I think that's the way things are. And a theory that helps you understand and engage with that, I think, is a good theory. Now, whether or not you think identity politics is a good or bad thing is a rather different issue. And the point there is that when people use the expression identity politics, they're using it in a pejorative sense to dismiss other people's identity-related concerns. Everybody does identity politics, especially people who decry the idea of identity politics. So there's a real, I think, irony there that actually the people who get most upset about it are the people for whom this is actually a pretty fundamental and foundational activity.
Mm-hmm. I'll be honest with you, Professor Haslam, I'm one of those people who decry the idea of identity politics because I hate being put in a box, you know, that you always just see me as an immigrant in the UK, that you always just see me as a brown person, but I just want to be known as someone else, you know, distinct from my immutable characteristics. I just want to be known as a YouTuber, as someone who has created content, rather than, you know, seeing me on the prism of, you know, a brown guy or a BAME, and I actually hate the word BAME, and I think that's the kind of, you know, That sounds really bad if you just keep on obsessing about identity. Yeah. And I'm not saying that's the kind of work that you're doing.
No. And I completely take the point. I mean, mm-hmm. one of the things is, and again, I think what you're saying there is also a difference between the politics and the sociology, mm-hmm. if you like, of identity and the psychology of it. So again, you know, there's an interface between the politics of identity, like how mm-hmm. people treat you, and the psychology of it, how you want to be treated. And all of our work actually focuses on people's own psychological realities, like what identities matter to you. In fact, I was just working on something about this today and saying, look, if you want to do something in organizations with identity, it's a big mistake, a really big mistake, to make assumptions about what identities matter to people and why. Yeah, if I believe that because you're from a, you know, your particular ethnicity or particular cultural background or whatever, that those things matter to you and that you have a particular take on them, and I make those assumptions without in any way engaging with your psychological reality, I'm going to get it badly wrong. I'm going to get leadership wrong. I'm going to get mental health wrong. And actually, one of our arguments is that psychologists, ironically, have not developed very good tools for understanding identities in the way that they matter to people. And actually, one of the things in our own research is we move away from a lot of standard questionnaire type approaches to these things and look at this process called social identity mapping, where I basically say to you, okay, what groups matter to you? How important are they? What's the nature of your connection to those groups, and how do those groups relate to each other? And if I want to lead you, and if I want to understand your mental health, that's how I need to engage with you. And too much of psychology imposes assumptions about those things on people. And you're absolutely right that that's alienating for people. It makes them feel that they've been pigeonholed. It makes mm-hmm. them feel misunderstood. And that misunderstanding is at the root of lots of problematic forms of behavior in psychology. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Now, let's move on to let's move back to leadership. What can companies do to improve their leadership framework in relation to the pandemic?
Okay, so, you know, another huge question. I mean, I think the starting point for us is you've got to understand that leadership is not a process that's just about individual leaders, okay? Mm-hmm. That actually leadership is a group process. And that in that process, the critical resource is not the, you know, the traits, abilities, and capabilities of individual leaders as individuals. Mm-hmm. The critical resource is that sense of shared identity that leaders are able to represent, embed, and advance. And if you look at the pandemic, and you look very straightforwardly around the world at countries where leaders have been very successful, and the obvious countries, I think, are places like New Zealand, to a certain extent Australia. What you see is that leaders have done a very good job of, if you'd like, building that sense of shared identity and then consolidating that and building compliance around it. If you look at places where they've done it badly, what you see is that a lot of the time they've fixated on their personal needs. Mm-hmm. Or they've focused it on the needs of particular subgroups, and they've actually created division within their communities. And the obvious case there, I think, is the US. But I think there's been some of that in the UK too. And I think the government at times has got that right in the UK, but at times they got it wrong. I think the whole Cummings saga was a really good example of actually that communicated the idea there's one rule for us and one rule for you. And that mm-hmm. undermined that sense of shared identity in ways that were really unhelpful for compliance and the kind mm-hmm. of behavior that you wanted people to engage in mm-hmm. order to have the most functional response to the demands of the epidemic management.
Mm-hmm. So just recently you wrote a book about the psychology of COVID-19 and leadership. Can you tell us more about the book?
Well, yeah. So that book is really about actually this mm-hmm. idea. Early in the pandemic, the governor of New York, Andrew Cuomo, made the thing that if we're going to manage this pandemic effectively, we've got to get our head around the we thing. That was the line that he used. It's not all about me, me, me. And if you think that the pandemic is all about personal rights and where you are as an individual, that's not necessarily going to put you in the right place to do leadership. It's not going to put your community in the right place to come up with a response. So what leaders have to do, and again, I come back to the sort of Jacinda Ardern case, or some of the Scandinavian leaders, I think, have done a particularly good job of this, you know, is you've got to cultivate that sense that we're all in it together. You've got to make that real. And then you've got to, you know, build policy around us all being in it together so that we look after each other and we have policies that ensure that we look after each other and that the most vulnerable amongst us are looked after and able to play their part. Because I think one of the problems in Britain is you have a lot of rhetoric around we're all in this together, but actually when you look at it, you know, there's some people are are in a lot better place than others. And what you see is that throughout the pandemic, for example, vulnerable populations, whether they're in care homes or whether they're frontline NHS workers, haven't always been given the protection that they needed in order to safely negotiate the challenges that COVID presents.
Mm-hmm. Now, as a psychologist, you also explore the role of group processes to the dynamics of intergroup relations and conflict. Can you tell us more about your work in this area?
Okay, in some ways, I can segue into that by answering your previous question a bit better. So our book, Together Apart, is really an attempt to provide a sort of social identity analysis of various aspects of the psychology around the pandemic. So there's an introduction to social identity thinking. I think it's a relatively readable one. Then there's a section on social influence, which talks about things like leadership. It also talks about followership. It talks about behavior change, which is again a big topic. And it also talks about the influence of things like conspiracy theories. Mm-hmm. Then there's a section on health, and in particular mental health, and that talks about the importance of social connection during the pandemic, why that's important, but also of course why it's threatened by the pandemic itself. It also talks about the ways in which people perceive threat as a function of their group membership. So one of the interesting things about a virus is that people, for example, are much more sensitive to threats that emerge from outside their group than they are to threats from within it. So one of the things, for example, is, you know, we tend not to worry so much about mingling with other members of our in-group, and that actually is hugely problematic, okay, because actually then we don't do things like engage in physical distancing and so on. So there's some interesting stuff around that. The fourth part of the book really deals with issues of just collective action and how people behave in groups. And also, and in particular, what are the conditions under which they engage in compliance with health policy and directives, and when do they not? But also then, when do they engage with and embrace, you know, the broader agenda of a government or of policymakers, health makers, and when do they resist? And perhaps when do they get very upset about things and start to, rise up against governments in ways that actually you've seen in the US, for example. So there's interesting stuff there. And how to police the pandemic is a really big issue. Like, how do you deal with people who don't follow the law or don't do what they're asked to do? And there's some real challenging issues there. And then the final issue is, this issue that you just asked about, and this is in the end of the book, is about intergroup relations. And one obvious point about COVID is that one set of social relations that have a lot of relevance for how we manage it, not just in our countries but across countries, is to do with intergroup relations. So for example, it's clear that in the early stages of the pandemic it wasn't managed very optimally because people and governments in particular were insensitive or didn't take seriously information which emanated from outgroups. So, for example, in Europe, people didn't listen to what the Chinese authorities were saying because they said, oh, that's China, it's not going to affect us. And then in Britain, they didn't listen to what was happening in Spain and Italy because they said, oh, those are the continental Europeans. And you see that replicated around the world. So again, and more generally, the ways that we're managing this in a global way rely or on and are a function of, you know, intergroup relations. So at the moment, for example, you know, I think tensions between, for example, the US and China, and tensions between Britain and continental Europe are meaning that the virus and the ways in which we might manage it are not managed as well as they might be. So social relations at that large level have a huge impact on the individual behaviors, whether we listen to what other people have to say, whether we communicate effectively with them, and also whether, most critically, whether or not we work with them to produce the optimal set of outcomes that we need to achieve to, you know, to deal with this at a global level, which is you know, obviously a huge issue.
Mm-hmm. Now, could you also talk to us how group processes contribute to stress?
Okay, so again, fast moving agenda here, but just stepping back a moment now, one of the interesting things about social identity, shared identity, and that sense of usness, is that it's the basis for social support. So who do we give support to? We give it to in-group members before we give it to out-group members. Who do we receive support from? Well, we receive it more from in-group members than from out-group members. And interestingly, research also shows that when we're given support, if we're given support by in-group members, this is more beneficial because we interpret it in the manner in which it's intended. But when we get support from out-group members, we're often suspicious and we don't treat it as seriously as we might. Now, if you're talking about stress, one of the things we know about stress is that stress is hugely conditioned by social support. Mm-hmm. But social support, we argue, is grounded in shared identity. So for support to help us manage stress, it has to be structured by a sense of shared identity. If you're stressed and I give you support to help deal with it, well, if you see me as an out-group member, and for example, I might just be giving you some sort of treatment or therapy. If I give you that therapy, if you see me as an out-group member, you won't find that support as helpful, in part because you won't take it as seriously, you'll be suspicious about it. And again, what you see in managing all manner of stress, from relatively minor forms of stress to, you know, chronic forms of stress like burnout or PTSD or something of that form, you see that responses to that stressor are hugely conditioned by the relationship you have with the people who are trying to help you deal with it. And actually, one of the things that we argue is that social identities and group memberships are critical for helping us to manage stress effectively. And that if you don't attend to group dynamics in that stress management process, you actually might exacerbate the situation. And you, in particular, you're going to limit the opportunities for stress to have positive consequences, for it to lead to particular types of growth. Because the obvious point is that, you know, a world without stress is not necessarily a good world, but when we can help manage stress in group contexts, that allows us to respond adaptively to it and to use stressor as a challenge rather than as a threat, in a ways that can be developmental rather than, problematic and health compromising. I mean, to be honest, that's just one aspect of our analysis of stress. But I think I'm just using that as an example because it ties with some of the points that we've made already.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned something about providing support within the group. I'm not quite familiar with your work, but is that what you call social cure?
Well, the social cure is really just the idea that groups have the capacity to be curative. That in many ways, the most natural way or structures that we have for dealing with, you know, mental health challenges, whether it's stress or other types of things, is the social group. And that our work is really about how to harness those curative properties. Groups actually can also be harmful for mental health if we don't manage them appropriately. So sensitivity to the importance of groups for health, and we have a lot of data showing that groups and group memberships are incredibly important for things like depression and stress and trauma and addiction and pain and all sorts of things, okay? So understanding why groups matter for health and then managing groups and group relations appropriately is, we argue, a critical mechanism and a critical pathway to remedial forms of intervention. And actually, we've done research now, we've got published research, which shows that interventions which focus on building, consolidating, embedding meaningful group memberships have a range of psychological and other health benefits that are equivalent to those of the best forms of psychological intervention, things like CBT and so on. So if you get these social dynamics right, then that puts you in the best position to manage mental health adaptively. And we'd argue that that reflects the fact that groups are the basic building block of human society. We were developed to function in groups. And so groups are the most sustainable forms of health maintenance and health enhancement. And if you look at, for example, something like CBT, many of its most effective elements are actually elements that capture this reality, the importance of social ties and of behaviors which build and consolidate social ties.
Mm-hmm. Now, let's move on to another aspect of your work. You did a TED talk on the psychology of tyranny. For those who have not seen your talk, did Milgram get it wrong?
That's an interesting question. Did Milgram get it wrong? I mean, Milgram, I think was a very good capable and insightful researcher who, identified really important issues and set about answering them in I think, useful and meaningful ways. So as a researcher, as a scientist, I think he was a very good scientist. Mm. What I think he got wrong, and again, I don't know how much about his work your listeners know, but I think if most people who know something about psychology know something about Milgram. What he got wrong was to suggest, as I think he did, basically, that people blindly follow authority and that people naturally conform to the requirements of people in authority or naturally follow their instructions. I don't think that's right, and I think our own research shows that that's right. Similarly, I think our own research also, and in fact, perhaps in a more straightforward way, our research challenges the conclusions of people, and in particular work by Philip Zimbardo and his colleagues, which suggest that people conform blindly to the requirements of roles in ways that lead them more or less inevitably to be tyrannical if they're in a situation where it seems to be expected of them to behave in tyrannical ways.
Mm-hmm. Now, tell us about the BBC prison study.
Yeah, so that relates really to the body of work that I've just spoken about. So the basis for the BBC prison study was actually a much better known, much more influential, a study that everybody who knows anything about psychology would know about, and that's a Philip Zimbardo and colleagues Stanford prison experiment. That was conducted in 1971 at Stanford University in the basement of the psychology department there. And in that study, participants were randomly assigned to be prisoners and guards. And as that study is reported, what it found and showed was that if you took normal, decent human beings, students, and assigned them to be guards in this prison-like structure, that they would behave in toxic, cruel, sadistic, tyrannical ways because that seemed to be required of them by the roles they had been given. Because the participants understood a prison as a situation which had a range of toxic roles, which involved, for example, abusing other prisoners, because that's what they thought prisons were about, they naturally conformed to those role expectations and therefore abused the participants in the study, the prisoners. Well, for a range of reasons, my colleague Steve Reicher and I, who I've actually also worked with on the leadership research I talked about, you know, we had some doubts about this and the idea that people naturally conform to roles. Mm-hmm. And so we designed a study to explore this idea, and we looked to replicate at certain aspects of the Stanford Prison Experiment. But the critical thing was that in our study, we did not assume a role of leadership. In Zimbardo's study, he took on the role of prison superintendent, and the other experimenters also had formal leadership roles in the prison, and roles in which, as we now know, thanks to other work and recent work that's been done in the Stanford archive, roles in which those experimenters took it upon themselves to give instructions to the participants about how to behave. That's the first thing. Mm-hmm. And so rather than, if you like, tyranny being a product of natural conformity to roles, we argue that it's a product of leadership of a form which encourages followers, or some followers, to identify with toxic role requirements. But what we argue there is that leadership was critical to the Stanford Prison Study, and leadership of a particular form, social identity leadership, or identity leadership as we call it. And then in our own research, some of it in the Milgram paradigm, some of it in the BBC prison experiment, supports that argument and shows, yes, that leadership is critical here, but it's also leadership which cultivates identification with a set of toxic goals and a toxic agenda, and encourages people to identify with that agenda by seeing it as worthy and moral and right, so that when people do bad things, it's not because they're conforming to toxic roles, it's because they believe in and identify with a particular set of goals and believe them to be good, okay, and worthy. And that's the aspect and the analysis or understanding of this, of the Stanford Prison Experiment and Milgram's research, which we argue is sort of chronically missing from Zimbardo and Milgram's analysis, but which we argue that work needs in order for it to make any sense, and indeed in order for us to draw the right and important lessons from that research. But as things stand, you know, I have to say, look, you know, Philip Zimbardo and his colleagues, Milgram and his colleagues, you know, their analysis is much more influential than ours. You know, I hope that in the fullness of time, people read our work and they see how it makes sense of those studies, but we've got a long way to go on that yet before that's the case. So I wouldn't want to pretend to you that our analysis is the mainstream analysis of this topic. It absolutely isn't.
Mm-hmm. Now, Professor Haslam, together with Michelle Ryan, you coined the term glass cliff. What does it mean?
Okay, so the glass cliff refers to the tendency to appoint women or members of other minority groups to leadership positions that are in some way suboptimal, typically because they're precarious, because they're in groups and organizations or units that are often failing. So in our original research, we just showed that that was the case, that if you had a failing organization, that people would be more likely to appoint a woman to lead that organization than a man, and that most women got their, you know, leadership opportunities in the context of these kind of suboptimal positions. So the basic idea there is majority group members, you know, whether they're white or male or whatever it is, often get kind of plum leadership jobs, but the less optimal jobs often go to members of minority groups. And the glass cliff kind of describes that tendency then. And the kind of point about it is that it relates to the idea of a glass ceiling. So again, all of your listeners will have heard of the phrase the glass ceiling, the idea that women are denied access to senior leadership roles because there's a sort of ceiling there that they can't get through. And our argument really was, well, that after women break through the glass ceiling, which is happening in increasing numbers, actually there's another kind of problem that they face, which is that the positions that they get given are often not as good as those that are given to their, you know, majority group member counterparts. So really that was that line of research. And to be honest, again, over time, I think Michelle and her colleagues at the University of Exeter have done more in that domain than I have. So I collaborated in some of the original research and some of the publications since. But I think that work has been, as I said, led primarily by Michelle, particularly in recent years.
Mm-hmm. Now, you've also done some work on stereotypes and prejudice. This is a fairly broad question, but what's the most effective way to address prejudice?
Oh, okay. Well, I think the first thing, I think the first thing is you've got to have a pretty sophisticated understanding of what prejudice is, and so on. And I think one of the problems in the whole field of stereotyping and prejudice is that people have, I think, a relatively limited understanding of what prejudice is, probably a faulty understanding, and that as a result, they have, a faulty understanding of what the problem that needs to be treated is. Mm-hmm. So actually, and in very, very simple terms, you know, people think that prejudice is just a cognitive problem. You know, that if I'm prejudiced against a particular group, that's because I've got a cognitive problem. Well, I think that's just not true. I don't think that prejudice is a cognitive problem. If it is a cognitive problem, it derives from problematic intergroup relations of some form, which then are understood by some people from in a particular position to be problematic. So, and actually then if I then set about trying to deal with that prejudice problem by, as it were, dealing with the person as if they've got a cognitive problem, I think the chances of that being successful by any meaningful measure of success are incredibly limited. For a start, because it's quite often the case that a person doesn't even acknowledge they've got a problem because they don't acknowledge that the foundation of prejudice. What they have is a problem of intergroup relations that leads them to manage intergroup relations in a particular way that we understand as prejudicial. Now, that's a very, you know, that's a very different type of answer, and it's a very different type of solution. But for example, one thing that our analysis suggests very straightforwardly is that you can't treat prejudice as an unconscious bias. It's not a cognitive bias. And then you can't, and the way to deal with prejudice is not through unconscious bias training. That's just palpably, in my view, nonsense.
Mm-hmm. You said that prejudice is not a cognitive problem. So what is it then?
As I say, prejudice is a problem of social relations, social relations that are perceived by some or all members of the community to be problematic in some way, or to give rise to things that are problematic, like, which really are problematic, like, you know, mistreatment of particular groups and so on. So if you say to me, like, let's take the current situation around Black Lives Matter and prejudice, the fundamental problem there is not that white people don't understand Black people or that they've got a bias. No, the problem is there's a history of particular social relations which has given way or given rise to particular understandings of social relations and particular treatments of groups which lead to particular outcomes. But again, to understand those dynamics, you have to look at them through the lens of all of the participants there and the group identities that they bring to that situation, whether they're Black or white, or whether they're progressive or reactionary or whatever it might be. And again, Prejudice is a name that we give to a particular type of social relations which we perceive to be problematic from a particular vantage point, a particular point in time. Okay, but the underlying issue is one of social reality, is of the way that particular groups are treated within a society or a community, and therefore the path to progress has to be in the way that you manage those social relations. And it's about social reality or perceived social reality, not psychology. And one of the real problems of psychology, one of the real problems of psychology and one of the real problems of prejudice is that we think that prejudice is a psychological problem. And we think that it's primarily just the job of psychologists to treat prejudice. No, neither of those things are true. Actually, the problem is to do with social reality. And if we want to get rid of prejudice, the best way to do that is to change social relations in meaningful ways that obliterate particular forms of toxic intergroup difference. Like, for example, we have to create a world in which a particular class of people is not badly treated. And if you stop doing that, lo and behold, you'll find the prejudice disappears.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to touch upon those points that you've raised. Would you agree with my observation, and I'm kind of revealing my position here, would you agree with my observation that social psychology or any other fields in social science has now become a form of movement, a sort of activism? It's quite common now to social psychologists to use words like social justice, and you would also have leaders of psychological bodies, you know, changing their profile to fit in with the current political landscape. So would you agree that social psychology, which is supposedly a form of psychology, has now become, they've become activists of some sort?
Firstly, look, I haven't talked about it, but I do work in the field of sport. For example, someone works on sports psychology. We've got a book on sports psychology coming out in a few months' time. Look, you know, all sport is necessarily political, okay? Mm-hmm. All clinical psychology, all psychology, you know, is political because you're talking about social relations, you're engaging with those social relations. Now, mm-hmm. if you say my work is not political, that itself is a political statement, okay? Mm-hmm. So one thing is that you can't just have, there is no such thing as an apolitical psychology. And actually, interestingly, I think science in general, is shot through with politics, just like sport is, you know, and that can be a very micro level, just what gets funded, what doesn't get funded, but also mm-hmm. how you have to position yourself in relation to things that are going on in the world in order to get funding or to get support for your research. Those things mm-hmm. are true, whether you're a social psychologist, whether you're an epidemiologist or whether you're a physicist, okay? So it's a mistake to think that physics is not political. I mean, you're not ever going to find a physicist who tells you it's political, but if you talk to them, it's very clear that they know it's political. I've got friends who are physicists, and it's very clear that they understand how to be successful as a physicist. You have to kind of do politics in a particular way, you know, and that opens up doors to funding and to people being interested in your research and so on and so forth. So I'm saying, you know, it's a mistake to think that any intellectual activity or any scientific activity is not science. It absolutely kind of is. Now, but I also think, you know, I am a psychologist. I'm not a politician, and I'm certainly not an activist. Okay, so if I do politics, and I do a certain amount, not that much actually, I probably should do more. But if I do that, that is not bound up with what I do as a psychologist. My goal as a psychologist is to understand psychological processes, and if I think that my job as a psychologist is to, you know, drive social change or to be a social commentator or something of that form, I'm probably mm-hmm. going to conflate things in ways that make me a worse mm-hmm. political activist and almost definitely make me a worse psychologist. So I'm very much a fan of rendering unto Caesar the things that are Caesar's. Yes, social psychology, like lots of other aspects of psychology, is at the interface between science mm-hmm. and society. But you've absolutely got to make sure you don't get cross-contamination of your thinking in those spaces. And at the end of the day, yes, I'm a scientist, and what I do has to withstand empirical scientific scrutiny. And if it doesn't, it's not worth anything.
Mm-hmm. Now, we've talked about your work. My next questions would be about, you know, getting to know Professor Haslam more as a person. So is that particular individual who has the greatest influence on your work or any particular piece of work?
Well, I mean, my PhD supervisor, John Turner, who I worked, I came to Australia to, as I said, to work with him in 1986. I worked with him pretty much up until his death in 2012. I actually just moved back to the University of Exeter just a bit before. I'd moved back about it, sort of 8 years or so before then. But I was always working with him, and I was always in contact with him. We were always working together on stuff. I mean, he was a, he was a brilliant thinker. I don't think there's a word that he ever wrote that isn't worth reading, and thought through and consistent with something else that he said and that didn't make a contribution to literature. He was not particularly prolific. He didn't publish a lot. He was a great thinker, and he had lots of really important and powerful things to say that were very revolutionary at the time. But in particular, they laid the groundwork for lots of the work that I and my colleagues have done. So, yeah, he was a huge influence on my life. But the other point I would generally make there is, in terms of the arguments that I've been making here, look, the key to my success, if such as it is as a scientist, is very much to do with the group ties that I have and the collaborators that I have. So I have a range of really good collaborators at the University of Queensland. I've had really good collaborators at the Australian National University, the University of Exeter in the past. But also I have ongoing collaborations with, fantastic researchers around the world, people like Steve Reicher, Michelle Ryan, you've mentioned, but just a raft of other people. And at the end of the day, I think pretty much everything that I've achieved has been a collaborative product to which I have brought something. But the story of my CV, as it were, or my thinking here, is a story of partnership. And I think if you fetishize or fixate too much on me, the individual, or if I do that, you're going to misunderstand what, has made me as a scientist work and what motivates me and what I kind of enjoy about being a psychologist and being an academic for that matter. And what I enjoy about it is just the opportunity for, creative, productive, energizing partnerships.
Mm-hmm. Can you tell us some of the misconceptions about social identity, about group processes that you've come across, and sort of, address those misconceptions?
That's a really complicated question, because there's two or three I think that really stand out, and again, I think the best way to understand misconceptions about social identity is just to go and look at a sort of an average textbook on social identity and see what it says. Okay. Mm. One of the things there's a couple of things. One is that if a social psychology textbook or a psychology textbook has something about social identity, one thing is it will probably just be in the section on intergroup relations. So it won't talk about all these other things that we've talked about, like health, or about communication or motivation. It will have a very narrow focus and say, social identity, that's just relevant to intergroup relations. And in particular, it will probably talk about the minimal group studies, which was work by Henri Targeville and his colleagues, including John Turner, actually in the 1970s. So it will talk about those studies as if social identity is all about those studies and ignore the fact that now there's 40 years of research by hundreds of researchers around the globe, which has massively increased, our breadth of knowledge about social identity and its relevance to human behavior in general. So there's a huge misconception about social identity, which is it's only relevant to this very narrow set of things, and it's all about in-group bias or something like this, the way in which we just naturally discriminate against out-groups. And that idea, if there's a single idea that's associated with social identity, it's that one, and that's actually completely wrong. So there is nothing in our psychology that means that if we identify with a group, that means that we necessarily treat out-groups badly. But yet that view is often ascribed to social identity theory or social identity theorists. It was not a part of the original formulation of social identity by Targeville and Turner. It's not anything that a serious social identity theorist believes, but yet it's reproduced in most textbooks. So again, in a way, it's a kind of an irony that if people have heard about social identity, then probably what they think they know about it is actually wrong. So yeah, that's a pretty big problem. And one of the issues there is that people approach social identity through the lens of the prejudices that they have acquired as a trained psychologist, because they think about psychology in terms of things like cognitive bias. Well, actually, our research and the research that I was talking about and fields of prejudice and stereotyping really challenges the idea of cognitive bias as a construct and argues, no, yeah, we get, you know, what our so-called biases reflect social group-based realities as apprehended from a particular point of view at a particular point in time. And that sensitivity or that understanding is almost completely absent from most people's understanding of this body of work.
Mm-hmm. And how do you relax? What's your distressing outlet?
How do I relax? I do Zoom calls at 8 o'clock at night with foreign countries. That's probably the first really serious, you know, really problematic question you've had. I worry that I don't relax as much as I should, partly because I don't get a lot of time to do it, because actually I feel I have a lot of commitments and I feel a lot of obligations to the community of which, the many communities in which I'm part. Once upon a time, I went to university at St Andrews and I used to play a certain amount of golf when I was there, and I actually got a scholarship to go and study at Emory University in the States, and so I was quite a keen golfer. But unfortunately, I played golf last week, and that was the first time I played for 3 years, and I thought that was absolutely pathetic. That it had taken me, you know, golf and getting out and spending time with other people, you know, in outdoors is a good thing, and I feel bad that I don't do it more often. But I have made a resolution to do fewer calls late at night with people overseas and do play golf more often. But I have as yet failed to deliver on that promise that I've made to myself.
Okay. Now, finally, what else is in the pipeline? You mentioned something about your book on sports psychology. Aside from that, what else?
Yeah, that's been quite a big thing, actually. So I've been working with Steve on the leadership thing. I've been working with colleagues on Belgium and around the world, actually, on the sport book, and that's a big thing too. Then we had the pandemic, and obviously that created a whole set of other things. I think there's plenty there to keep me and my colleagues going. I guess I've got a couple of things that I would like to do. I would like to write maybe one day a sort of popular book about myths of social psychology and sort of like a book which just, you know, very a basic level book that anybody could read, everybody and anybody, and it would just like tell them like it is and debunk a whole stack of myths around social psychology, which I think are so embedded in our discipline. It's incredible. They're like barnacles rusted on. We've got one book actually I wrote with or edited with Joe Smith, and again, lots of colleagues from around the world, called Social Psychology Revisiting the Classic Studies. And that was an attempt to go back over all these studies that everybody thinks they know, but which when you look at it, they've got wrong. That book was an attempt to kind of garner all the information about the ways in which we've got that wrong. And I think that was actually a pretty good book. It's done pretty well. But I think there's scope to write a more popular book around that for just the sort of people who are listening to this podcast and maybe think, okay, that sounds kind of interesting and I'd like to get a sense of how that fits together. But look, I'm not an academic psychologist. I'm not a research scientist. So tell me it straight and in easy to understand terms. Help me get my head around this. I can see there's a value to doing that. I wouldn't want to underestimate the difficulty of writing a good book like that. So actually the book I have in mind is a colleague of mine is an economist. His name's John Quiggin, and he's written a book which is called Zombie Economics. And it's a lovely book actually. And it just explains how economics as a field is wedded to a whole set of theories and ideas like trickle-down economics, which have been proved time and time again to be wrong. But he makes the point that economics is populated by these kind of zombie ideas and zombie theorists who just go on saying the same thing again and again about Milgram or Zimbardo or other kinds of studies in psychology. So the book I might want to write is called Zombie Psychology, and really just unpacks where we've got it so badly wrong, but in a way that's maybe just a little bit engaging and maybe just a little bit humorous and a little bit light, you know, in a way. So, I apologize to all the people who have listened to this podcast, because, you know, I have a bit of a hectoring tone and I'm always shouting. I'm not really. I'm trying to be enthusiastic and engage people.
You're just passionate.
Passionate, yeah, that kind of thing. But sometimes that can be understood as just aggressiveness or just bloody-mindedness, you know, and there is a bit of that in me, and some of my writing has a bit of that edge, or our writing, I should say. So I think it's provocative. I want to be provocative, but I want to take people with us on the journey. I think it's a very bad place to start just by telling people that they're wrong. I think you've got to take them on a journey, and you've got to treat them as fellow passengers, you know, and I don't think as psychologists we always do that as well as we might. And that applies to me as much as anybody else.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's been an insightful conversation with you, Professor Haslam, but unfortunately our time is up and I know you're very busy. But yep. Thank you for sharing your time and expertise. I look forward to hearing more about your work and your book on zombie psychology. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dennis. It's been good talking to you. And thanks for a really good set of questions. You covered a lot of ground there. And you'd obviously done your research well, which is something I really appreciate. So good luck with your podcast. Good luck with your program. And I hope you and your work has the impact that it deserves too. So thanks very much for the invitation. And thanks to everybody for listening as well.
Thank you.